This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is going to be episode 339, Emcomm Extra, number 14. Wirecast is not happy doing that. I hope that worked out on your side. There we go. Emcomm Extra number 14, minimal impact. And get rid of that. Oh yeah. See, I'm still working on this title thing. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. There we go. If you enjoy the programs and me struggling with the titles, hamradionow.tv is the place to go. Click the pig. We're always trying to get into your pocket and get some money. And now I can make all that stuff go away and see who I'm talking to. Well, I can see some of the people I'm talking to, and not all of them. On the left-hand side of the screen is our co-host, David Goldenberg. Hi. Hello, David.
Hello, Gary. How are you doing today?
Good. I can still hear you. It's always good when that part is still working.
Everything's working so good.
Yeah, well, this is a last-minute show. We just scrambled together to put something together because at the very last minute, there was sort of an Emcomm thing going on down there in Florida. Yep. Okay. It appears to have fallen apart. That's why we're calling the show Minimal Impact. The little blue phone thing that you're seeing is because the guy there. I'm talking to, our guest, is only got telephone. Doesn't have Skype video and barely has telephone at this point because of the rain. We'll let him explain that. It is Darrell Davis, KT4WX. Darrell is the section manager for the West Central Florida section of the ARRL and the emergency coordinator for Hardy County, which I assume is in the West Central Florida section. And hello, Darrell, have we got you here?
Hello, Mr. Gary. And yes, sir, you're right. It is one of the 10 counties in the West Central Florida section.
Okay. And you are rural. You don't have cable, don't have DSL.
Yes, sir, that is correct. I'm out in the south end of Polk County, actually, probably about 10 miles north of the Hardy County line. I'm between State Road 64 and State Road 60, and we're in the middle of nowhere. And as a result, we do not have cable modem service that's available out here. We don't have DSL service through the phone company either, and there's no WiMAX providers that reach out into our area. Ironically, Hardy County has a WiMAX provider thanks to a federal grant, but we don't have one in this area. Go figure. So, yeah, I'm using Exceed, and that's if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't have any internet other than tethering to my smartphone.
So, okay, so Exceed is what? What is Exceed?
Exceed is a satellite-based internet service from ViaSat. It's a competitor to HughesNet. It's one of the HughesNet's competitors, and I think it's their only competitor that I'm aware of at the moment. Mm-hmm.
All right, so you're on satellite, and it is it's raining a little bit. Let me see if I can dial up what I was looking at here. What happened this morning, and this just popped up this morning, is the Weather Service announced Tropical Storm Emily, and it was going to make landfall this afternoon on right in the middle of your section, West Central Florida section, right around Tampa, St. Petersburg area. So,
yes, sir, that is correct.
Yep. So it was going to be a tropical storm. It was never going to be a hurricane. They were talking about flooding and stuff like that. And so, it looks like it's, you're looking at the radar now, it looks like it's, pretty much just kind of falling apart. You can't see an eye, you can't see rotation, you can't see anything serious. What you can see is it's raining over your house, so your internet connection isn't very good.
Many times is it good, but sometimes it is. In the afternoons and evenings, whenever the most people are on, the bandwidth is shared. But in the morning and overnight, it's okay. You can do pretty good. But, yeah, you have to choose your moments, shall we say.
Mm. All right. And I just realized that my over-the-shoulder shot was set up for the old Fix-It show that we did last. So I can't use the over the shoulder, so I'm stuck with a couple of shots. Like, well, I can, I've still got that.
Do that one.
I've still got that. And I've still got that. I guess that'll be my over the shoulder shot. Although it really doesn't work because it doesn't show you guys. And for those that are just doing audio, you don't understand what I'm talking about at all. So
yeah, I'm sure Darrell doesn't either.
Right. So the reason for doing a show like this at all is to see what impact a minimal storm like Emily had that happened in an inconvenient time early on a Monday morning, not a weekend, on Aries activity. So what did you guys do? Did you do anything?
When I got up, like normally, now I drive a school bus during the school year, and I'm a part-time college student to boot, so I can get out of driving a school bus to eventually get into IT. But when I got up this morning, a little after 6 o'clock, I thought, oh, something spun up in the Gulf here. So I went and checked the National Hurricane Center advisories and any statements issued by the National Weather Service office in Ruskin, which Ruskin is a small town south of Tampa, about 25 miles. That's where the National Weather Service office that covers the Tampa Bay area, which ironically the West Central Florida section is entirely within the Ruskin coverage warning area, and one county in South Florida and four counties in Northern Florida, in the Northern Florida section, are in the Ruskin coverage warning area, or CWA. And I saw it, so I immediately got on the computer around 7 to 7:30, started composing a press release for the section website, which I had set up by an application called Zapier that will automatically post it to our Facebook and our Twitter pages. So I went ahead and composed a press release to the West Central Florida section, just advising everybody to check your advisories, check your supplies, every personnel, CERT, or ACS, because some areas are more ACS-oriented, some are strictly Aries. It depends on the individual county. And a heads up, be sure to be ready in case we are requested to deploy. The likelihood was very high that we would not be deployed, but also for Skywarn operators, just in case we have, you know, the possibility of a little bit of severe weather. Because the National Weather Service was thinking there was a possibility as landfall approached, it could be an outside chance of a water spout. And then I notified my personal Aries members via the Aries database. We use a database here in the West Central Florida section called Aries DB that Joe Tomasoni, AB2M, composed up. And he built the database in response to the September the 11th attacks on New York and Washington. And the database is used by a lot of Aries groups around the country. It's a very lean and trim database. It works very, very well. And another Aries group here in Polk County, they sent out alerts to their members. Hardy County did. I'm certain that Manatee did, which we were all closer to the area of impact. Also, I composed an email when I put out the press release on the section website. I also went to the ARRL page for our section, posted the same press release there, and then posted a notice to the ARRL members about the press release I initiated so I could reach the maximum number of people in the least amount of time, which in a situation, if there were really something really cooking, more people would say, hey, what's going on? You know, let's pay attention. So that was the actions I was able to take this morning on behalf of the section to try to, shout out, so to speak, and so folks could gear up if we were needed to do something, which thankfully we didn't. But they were prepared to, at least had some information to, be alert and be ready in case we did have to deploy.
So no deployment. And did the Skywarn Nets?
I'm aware of.
And you should be. You're the EC and section manager. Did Skywarn even get ginned up?
I was not aware of any nets on there. There's a linked repeater system here in the section, run by a group called the West Central Florida Group. To my knowledge, there was no Skywarn Nets. We did not have any severe watches or warnings that I was aware of. I was monitoring it on and off most of the morning. And now, if it was overnight, I was not aware of it when I was asleep, obviously. But there were no watches or warnings. The only thing we had was a flood watch that was issued for many of the counties here in the section and in the Ruskin CWA as well from Tampa, basically south. But we did not have any skywardness that I'm aware of. There were no activations that I've been notified of at this point anywhere in the section, again, that I'm aware of.
All right. So the only action that actually ever happened was you to use the tool that you're talking about to send out some notices via Twitter, via Facebook, email. Was email part of that?
Yes, sir. The ARRL remailer that I have access to as section manager, I initiated an email to all the section members of the ARRL. Of course, every ARRL member, you know, they can opt to be on the list. If you're a member, you check the little box on your membership profile called Section and Division News Releases. On your membership profile, you just log on to the ARRL website, go to your membership profile, and there's a little box there called Section and Division News. And if you check that, if I send an email to the section, every member as an ARRL member in the West Central Florida section will get that email. I can't attach pictures to it, but it's text only. But it's still a very useful tool to say, hey, you know, alerts up. And I also did it to the ARRL main site. They have a page for every section of their activities. I posted a notice on there, too, as well. So try to reach the maximum number of people in the shortest period of time.
What did you tell them?
I gave a summary of what the National Hurricane Center had put out, storm data about the storm. I even quoted in it one or two sentences about what the National Hurricane Center was their thinking in the forecast discussion. The forecast discussion, to me, is probably the most useful product they put out for me personally, because it's like the forecast discussion that your local National Weather Service puts out. It's on every website. You can go to their main page, no matter where you are, click on forecast discussion and read it. It tells you what the meteorologists are thinking when they write the forecast. And that is very, very useful to me personally. A lot of, you know, EM directors and folks in authority use that for decision-making. And it's, in my opinion, it's the most useful piece of information they put out. And I read that and quoted part of that. I just advised our ARRIES and ACS and CERT people out in the field to just pay attention, check your supplies, check your equipment in case we're activated. And Skywarn, just be on the alert just in case. And because we may not do anything now, but we may have to in the future. So if anything, it's a good small exercise to check your equipment, check your supplies to be sure that you'll be ready for when, God forbid, that we really have to go to work.
Okay. So that's what I'm really looking for is what do you do when it looks like it's not going to be much and doesn't turn out to be much? Go ahead, David.
Yeah, so Darrell, when you send out those communications to the folks in your area, are you asking them to stand by? Or are you asking for some kind of status availability? Or it's just a notice to say, hey, this is happening and something may occur going forward?
What we do after the fact, other emergency coordinators to send in reports that they were activated. And also, we have on our website a monthly reporting form as well. When they file their monthly reports, to be sure to put that data on there, because the ARRL does collect that data, and it's very useful to know these activities. And I try to have them to send me, and I'll go back to them this afternoon after the fact and request them all to send me if they were activated or not. And then, we collect that data so we know who was active, who was not. And in an emergency, our section emergency coordinator, Ben Henley, KI4IGX, who has been having some health issues as of late. He's had a heart condition. So I've been helping him out, and Andy K40ZM has been helping. We collect this data for him and try to get it accumulated for him so that way he will know who's been active, who has not, and do they need anything? Do they need any support? Our job in section leadership is not to tell the counties what to do. It's just to say, hey, we're here. Tell us what you're doing, and do you need any help? And the local ECs and their areas group take care of things on the ground in their areas of responsibility. And we are a grassroots organization, and I think it works best that way.
So it looks like go ahead, David.
Yeah, that's in Los Angeles. I'm an EC here as well in the LAX section, and that's kind of our motto too, right? We're we're not here to rescue you. We're just here to help if you need us, and let us know how we can help.
And sometimes it may be help. I need rescuing. If it gets bad enough, yes, what you're going to holler. So if they say, hey, help, I'm going down the hole, on to the last rope. Can you come help me? Then we try to get away. We try to look around and dig them up some resources to try to send to them. And we'll even call the other. During Matthew, we had calls from other sections requesting help, particularly the northern and southern Florida section that were on the East Coast. Well, specifically, it's the southern Florida section. They were the most impacted. We were trying to coordinate to get them help. So, it could go beyond section boundaries as well. So, I value the relationship we have with the northern and the southern Florida section. I nicknamed the three of us section managers. I called us the Florida Boys as a little bit of a joke, because when we get together, we're really good friends. And we get along very well, and we help each other out when we can. And we get together at the Melbourne and Orlando Hamcations and discuss between us as the three Florida sections, hey, this is what we're doing. Do you need any help? What can we do to improve things? And I think that's the way it should be.
So your initial email, Twitter, and Facebook postings in the website, there was no hint of a call-up at that point. You weren't getting people on the air. No nets were started up. It was just heads up. And it sounds like the any additional call-up was going to happen at the county level.
That's correct. The section that our primary served agency is here in the West Central Florida section, and probably in most of the other two sections as well, I would say, for the most part, by and large, would be the local emergency management office, which is organized in Florida. And then I know in other places in the country it's done different, but or it can be different. But here it's on the county level here in the state of Florida. And now there's some cities that have EM agencies of the larger cities particularly. But mostly it's primarily even they, as my understanding is, they would work through their local county EM office to interface to the state of Florida. And that's my understanding of how their system operates. And if I'm mistaken on that, then someone could correct me. But they would interface with their local office, and then they would go, the county EOC would then communicate with Tallahassee because of how the state of Florida is structured for the Florida Constitution. And we primarily EM as our served agencies. Now, some of our counties, they serve more than one agency, and that's fine. Some of them, they have relationships with their hospitals. Some of them have relationships very extensively with their Red Cross organization, or whatever the case may be. But primarily, it's the most of them, it's the emergency management office. And I know here in the West Central Florida section, that is true. But I believe in the other two sections, primarily, it's that way as well.
And Emily, there was no hint that this was going to turn into a tropical storm. Even last night, it was, totally early this morning as it brewed up. Got to as bad as it was going to get, which was not all that bad. And then I think landfall was at like 2 o'clock this afternoon. That's kind of unusual for a tropical storm or hurricane. Usually you get a little bit more warning. But I guess my question is, and David, you're used to the idea of no warning because you get the earthquake thing, and there's no warning on those. But how does Aries handle nobody's telling you it's coming?
Well, for us in Los Angeles, you figure out something happened, and then you have to figure out, is it time to jump on the net and see if somebody's activated the net? And if you think it's big enough, then you activate it yourself. And until someone, of a higher rank or status comes along and says, either we're going to run the net moving forward and figure out, what do our served agencies need, or shut it down and don't worry about it. For an incident like this, Skywarn net, so that we can report to NOAA, when we have rain here, and it's probably nothing like the rain you guys have in Florida, but we have an inch or two of rain an hour. Everybody here kind of gets in panic because then you get to flash floods and what have you. So we'll run up a Skywarn net for that, and folks will be at home watching their rain gauges and so on and so forth and reporting in. But otherwise, if there's an earthquake or, a couple of weeks ago we had an explosion, a big fire, and we lost power across the valley, folks are just supposed to know, you know, you get on either our the repeater system that we use, and if that's not working, we get on our main simplex frequency and, you know, put out a call and see who's there. And, you know, if you're the first one there and you're comfortable with doing it, you spin up a net and start looking for information, you know, across the regional area. And I'll assume, Darrell, that's kind of similar to what happens where you are when something happens.
Well, yes, sir, it is. Here in Florida during the summer, you can have, and also, well, mainly in the early summer, because in the early hurricane season, we could have something pop up in the Gulf. Sometimes with, like, in 12, 24 hours, and all of a sudden head your way. I mean, that happens usually every summer. We had a tropical storm, what was it, Colin, last summer, and it popped up in the Gulf and skirted to the West Coast. Then it was the East Coast turn in October with Matthew, which the Melbourne Ham Fest had to be delayed by a week because the original schedule, which created a lot of chaos with vendors and so forth coming to the Ham Fest, and it blew all the schedules apart. But and all of a sudden, it came up the East Coast in the fall. So, and then usually in October, like Wilma, 2005, it was a late season storm, and it was like Cat 2 or Cat 3. And they can blow up very quickly in the Gulf. You could have a storm sitting on you, sometimes with very little or no notice, particularly along the Big Bend area of the state. That's where the panhandle curves and turns into the peninsula. We call it the Big Bend area of Florida. It's a very, very rural, where Levy and Citrus counties are, and Taylor County up in that part of the state. Storms can pop up sometimes there along these troughs that will form, much like happened, you know, in the last day or two, and they can spin up with little or no warning. So, we know in the summer in Florida, you monitor satellite photos, you monitor the National Hurricane Center and the Weather Service office like a hawk. You're checking once a day or twice a day sometimes, because you want to know if something's going to spin up on top of you. So, yeah, we deal with different circumstances, but the same thing, where something's popping up sometimes with no warning.
And when you get that stuff, those things starting to pop up, do you guys work close with NOAA? Do you guys run SkyWatch to localized reports of this is what's going on here, or do you mostly focus on the satellite views and use that to plan?
There is a very active SkyWatch program here in the West Central Florida section. It's run by the National Weather Service office directly in reality, and has been for a little over 10 years now. But they get out every year. They teach SkyWatch classes at mostly a lot of the emergency operations center in the winter months when we're out of hurricane season. They don't usually do classes in the summer because, you know, the hurricane season's on. And that's when the meteorologists also have more time to get out into training. The majority of SkyWatch spotters are hams by and far in this area. I don't know if in other places in the country if that's true, but here it is. They're probably, we're 75% or more licensed hams. Most of your counties will have SkyWarn nets. A lot of the Aries groups foster that. They foster the SkyWarn net operations. Where I'm EC of, I have a SkyWarn coordinator. He takes care of SkyWarn nets in Hardy County. Polk County has a similar deal. And just about all the other counties here in the West Central Florida section, they'll have an assistant EC over SkyWarn, or they'll have a SkyWarn coordinator that works with the emergency coordinator for the Aries program. It's usually one of the two relationships. And the National Weather Service office does have an amateur radio station, WX4TOR. I forget what the TOR stands for, but that's the National Weather Service office amateur radio station in Ruskin, which they put the Weather Service office in Ruskin so the radar is not over the city of Tampa. They couldn't see Tampa. It's in downtown Tampa, obviously, because of the cone of silence around the radar dish. But so that's why the Weather Service office is in Ruskin, which is fairly rural. You wouldn't believe in a county with a city the size of Tampa that 20 miles away is a community of less than 10,000 people, but that's the way it is. That's the way it is here in Florida. But they do have a regional SkyWarn net they will activate on the what's called the NI4CE linked repeater system here that covers our entire section. It is run by called the West Central Florida Group. They're not a non-profit group of hams, and they run this linked repeater system. It has, I think, nine repeaters and five sites in the system, if memory serves me correctly. and the National Weather Service office, if there is a regional situation that will pop up, they'll call a regional Scott Warnett, like for a major hurricane situation, or if a cold front is coming down, it's very strong, like in an El Nino year, for example. They'll call up a regional net during that time. And the idea is that you go to your local county net if it's active and report weather there, and that net control or liaison will go by NWS chat right into the National Weather Service office. And also that net can have a liaison going to the regional net, and they can get word in that way as well. And now a lot of our weather here in Florida, it pops up, well, we have convective thunderstorms. Our weather is driven by the sea breezes in the summer. You have a sea breeze that forms on the Gulf Coast and on the Atlantic, and when they move inland, we don't have that right now because of the storm, but they'll move inland wherever those breezes meet, the thunderstorms will form, and it's like popcorn when you're watching our radar. Watch radar over Florida any afternoon, and it can be quite entertaining. And these storms can form, and 5 miles away can be ball dry. That's where our rain is here. You'll say, if you don't like the weather in Florida, wait 5 minutes. There's a lot of truth to that. And it'll form, rain, and an hour later it's done and it's dissipating. So our nets are often local in nature, but for like major cold fronts or storms, they will have a regional skywarn net that will activate to support the National Weather Service.
I was going to say, everybody everywhere says that if you don't like the weather, wait 5 minutes, it'll change. That's universal.
Not in Los Angeles.
Wait 5 years.
Yeah, well, or a month or two. Hey, FYI, we lost the Facebook, but I don't think it's worth stopping for, but I'll just let you know.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we'll put it back up. So you went through some of your infrastructure, since there really wasn't a storm to talk about much. One of the things I wanted to give you a chance, Darrell, to talk about is what communications infrastructure that you've got. That link system you were talking about, I believe you and I talked on as I was driving in toward the DCC in Tampa last September, which means you are one of the few people, one of the few people on the show that I've actually talked to on the radio. That never happens. I'd never talked to David on the radio. So
we'll work that out eventually.
Yeah. So, tell me a little bit more about the communications infrastructure that you've got. Let's start at each county level. Does each county have its own repeater?
Yes, they do, and some of them have linked together. The folks in Pasco are using fusion repeaters at the moment. They're working on linking theirs together. Now, you have the NI4CE system that's run by the West Central Florida group I talked about. You were talking to me that day when you were driving in on, I think it was Thursday, before DCC, on the WC4PEM system here in Polk County. Now, that's sponsored by Polk County Emergency Management. It's got four repeaters in it, three VHFs and three UHFs and one VHF. It started off as one repeater and then grew to four over the years. And it's a ham radio operator that he works for the county, but he's a ham, so he maintains it, keeps the equipment running. And as a matter of fact, there was an incident recently right after the 4th of July where a man, his cell phone apparently had died. He was up in Pasco County, but he could get into a repeater you were talking on, the one in Kathleen, which is near Lakeland. And that's on the northwest side of the county. All these repeaters are inside of Polk County. And the Polk County Aries uses this as their primary communications tool. But an example, now it does help, is he called out. He was having apparently a mini stroke, and his cell phone died. He had no landline, and didn't have a landline. So he called for help, and two amateur radio operators, and we're going to have a press release coming up on this soon that will be on the section website. I'm working on composing it right now about how they answered his call. And they got him connected to Pasco County 911, and they stayed on the radio with him. His, I think, granddaughter or daughter, I'm not sure. It was a young girl in the house with him. She talked on the radio with him laying on the floor. He couldn't hardly speak, but he was able to tell her, and they stayed on the radio with him, got the dispatcher, got through to the dispatcher due to a logistics situation. They were calling for Polk County, but this guy was in Pasco. They were finally able to get through, and they got an ambulance for the guy, and they got him medical assistance, and they stayed on the radio with him until the fire EMS was at the door, until they came in and they were inside the house. So that's where an incident swerved, man. And a repeater system, had it hadn't been there, he would have been hard pressed to get help. So he didn't have a phone. His cell phone battery's dead. They didn't have a landline. So they were able to get that gentleman some help, and they took him to the hospital, and he was able to get treatment. So that, you know, and this was like at 9:30 at night when it happened. So I guess a message out there is, you know, if you have a more local repeater in your Aries or ACS or CERT, monitor it. You know, something you may never happen, but one day it could happen. So, but getting back to superstructure, other counties, almost every county in our section has one or a series of two or three individual repeaters they're either they're linked together at the same site, or there are multiple sites linked together, like the system you and I talked on, that is here in Polk County, because Polk County is the largest geographical county in the state of Florida. It's over 2,000 square miles. As I understand, it's bigger than the state of Rhode Island, which is handy, or it's the same size as the state of Rhode Island.
Rhode Island is not very big.
So, but I mean, you're talking a county that's bigger than a state. I know there's counties out west that are far bigger than Polk, but still, it's the largest in Polk County, and so they were wise to have a linked repeater system, you know, to cover, because the geography is huge.
So how are those repeaters linked? Are they linked on ham radio RF, or do they rely on the internet?
My understanding is the ham system is 220 megahertz. NI4C, I'm not sure how they're linked at the moment. They were RF at one time, but now I'm not sure. I think they're maybe a mix of RF, a mix of voice over IP. I'm not really sure. I mean, you'd have to ask the West Central Florida group, but and other repeaters I know of here in the section are linked together RRF, because I personally like that idea, because, you know, you have some redundancy, of, you know, in case of failure. But that's my understanding of how they're linked together.
Yeah, I mean, I think anybody in Emcomm would say if you're going to link repeaters, then you got to do it by RF, because you can't count on the internet for sticking around. David, you don't like repeaters at all. You prefer simplex.
Well, I mean, we like them because we get a regional coverage, but, you know, in Southern California, there's, you know, there's two problems with that. If it shakes enough, not only you have the option of losing the internet, but, you know, if it shakes enough, you have an RF connection, usually those are very directional. You may throw off the directional and lose that, or, you know, systems go down and you may have partial coverage. We test, you know, we do weekly nets on the repeater system, because you can reach more people, but then we always follow up with like a simplex net to see, you know, how many people you have on an individual basis.
So Darrell, you said something that caught my attention. You said one of your groups is trying system fusion. That's one of the things I always want to ask when we're talking about how systems are being put together. It is how the digital modes are being integrated or not. And of course, most of the time, the answer is not that everyone's just using FM because it's what everybody's got. How are they doing that system fusion thing? How is that working out?
Currently here at the Winter Section, this is the layout of digital, and this is the way the cookie has crumbled. Down in Charlotte and Sarasota counties, they've gone the DMR route, which that's very popular, you know, because of the Tytera MD380s and the MD390 handhelds. And I understand they're coming out with a mobile or a dual band mobile as well, if I remember my read correctly. Now up in Manatee County and DeSoto to the south of Farney County, and also in Pasco, and there's a repeater here in Polk County, they're running fusion. I think the group in Pasco is going towards getting wires Xboxes for theirs. Manatee's got two fusions, DeSoto has three, Polk has one, Pasco has two, and in Hardy County, we're wanting to go fusion as well. A lot of us have the fusion radios now. There's also a DMR group here in Polk County as well, as three DMR repeaters. There is a little bit of NXDN, the NI4C group, they do that. They're doing the NXDN deal. And there's a few P25 repeaters around, mainly over in, I think, Pasco, I mean, Pinellas, the Oldsboro counties, with the Tampa Bay area and St. Pete area, obviously. But and there is one P25, I think, here in Polk, if I remember correctly. But we're wanting to go fusion in Hardy County, because the counties around us have gone fusion. And so we're looking at it. And also we can see it has some an Emcomm application for us, but we're going to have to do a fundraiser, it looks like, in order to raise the money to buy the repeaters. So because most of my guys now, the majority of them have Fusion equipment, but we're going to have to do a fundraiser eventually to get the repeaters we want. So that's where it's going. It's now Charlotte County's doing something interesting. They're doing on UHF Simplex, their digital stuff. And I'm trying to remember what mode they're using. It's a more traditional digital mode. It's not digital voice as per se, but they're doing it very successfully between the hospitals down there in Charlotte County, which is their other serve agency. And they've had very good, they do tests every month on it. They do a test with PACTOR, and they do a test with another mode. I can't remember what it is right now, but they do regularly test once or twice a month. And so they've gone that direction. So there is digital being used. It's just up to each county how and where they're going to use it.
Interesting. And
that's consistent across the country.
Yeah. And the word that comes to mind is interoperability. It doesn't sound like there's going to be much.
That's why we still got analog voice to depend upon. And we'll be an SCT coming up in a few weeks, ironically, on August 12th.
Yeah, that's
we had it planned since July the 8th. The idea is we'll communicate between the various county EOCs and the county EOCs and the state EOC on HF voice, and also between our EOCs locally on VHF simplex or using local repeaters. Here in the state of Florida, we have something I failed to mention a little bit ago. There's a network called the SARnet, the Statewide Amateur Radio Network. It's a series of like 29 or 30, mostly UHF repeaters. They're privately owned, but they're linked together using the Florida DOT backhaul network. Our sites are at the Florida DOT sites along the interstate, because along the major interstates here in Florida, DOT has a microwave backbone network that's, you know, exclusively theirs. And these repeaters aren't using that part of that because of bandwidth. They have some to spare, apparently. They're linking the repeaters together, and the system works very well. I'm really impressed. But for the purposes of the SCT, SARnet is off limits, and the NI4CE system will be off limits. So how do you communicate if those are not available? Can you use simplex? Can you use local repeaters that would maybe survive? So it's made us sit down, you know, think a little bit and scratch our head, think, what do I do now? So, but thankfully, yeah, we still got analog voice, so we all could at least talk to each other.
So has this digital voice system just sort of grown without a lot of thought and direction, or is anybody looking at it and saying, here are how all these pieces are going to be put together? With a county by county, and a, you know, different decision in each county, almost sounds like you got hams who, you know, whichever leadership favors one digital mode or the other, that's the one they're gonna choose.
Yes, that's right. Except for individual counties, because again, you know, it's a grassroots organization, and let them go with whatever they prefer. They think is best for them. Now the SARnet, I'll get back to that to make another point. That's an analog UHF system. That's analog voice. Now, you know, in an emergency, that could overload very quickly. But the idea is an emergency that all your county EOCs would be on it. Talking to the state EOC, then everybody else would have to stand by, would be the idea behind it. It would be for inter-county, county EOC to EOC, and EOC to state EOC communication. And they could, you know, that could get a little dicey, depending on, you know, what's happening and how much of it's happening. But, it's up to each individual group what they want to do, you know, within their own county, whether it be digital voice or, you know, or the digital data modes or whatever. And, we've not gotten that far yet. It's been talked about in the past more than once, but we've not reached that point yet.
So it sounds pretty ad hoc. It's not like someone said, here are the advantages to this mode, here are the advantages to that mode, let's make a good choice. And I don't think that any one stands out head and shoulders above the other. It's not like it's really clear. It's, but yet they still get their adherents that will argue till they're blue in the face that one is better than the other. So David, you stick with plain old analog and simplex as much as you can. David, can you hear me? Not sure David is.
You're breaking up a little bit, but yeah, that's if I understood, because you're pinging and ponging around. Yeah, you know, our kind of general rule is it's FM, simplex.
Yeah, I see you coming UHF, coming and going VHF, a little bit here too.
And we'll do some single side. Yeah, I got a couple minutes more that I'm going to have to drop off either way. But you're starting to. Your signal is worse, Gary, than Daryl's is. I'm not sure what's going on.
Yeah, the internet is failing us today. Daryl, let's talk the last thing about your HF nets. What HF facilities do you guys utilize?
The traffic nets here in Florida are unified. In other words, it's not on the HF level. Well, some areas have regional nets, but all the HF traffic nets in Florida are unified state nets and have been since the dawn of time, basically. You have
I'm not so interested in your traffic nets unless the traffic nets become Emcomm nets when they're needed. I'm wondering about your Aries nets.
I was trying to get them. These traffic nets, they meet these times of day every day. And in an emergency situation, they would be able to take off with welfare traffic, even emergency traffic if necessary. Each of the sections have an HF Aries frequency for use for their own section on HF. We're going to be using that on August the 12th. As a matter of fact, to try into the EIS between the county EOCs and the state EOC on we're going to try to see if 80, 60, or 40 meters, which one will be depending on what the time of day is and the MUF and so forth. But we do. Each section has its own HF Aries frequency, and we coordinate with Tallahassee through the North by agreement between the three sections. The North Florida Section Manager, Steve WB4OMM, is our liaison to Tallahassee because they requested you have three sections, but we want one voice to speak for ham radio, and so Steve is our one voice, and so far that's worked very, very well for us. And but actually, most of the counties, to add to a question you asked a minute ago, they're still using analog FM. But some areas, by local option, they use their digital modes. They have the equipment. But again, most of them are probably still using analog. And what's drove the digital deal is very simple. The fusion repeaters were $600. It was the price, the money. And the handheld radios for DMR, same thing.
Yeah, so they're cheap. All right. I'm glad to get a chance to talk to you down there, and hopefully the next time we do this, all of our internet infrastructure will be working a little bit better. It's interesting. One of the goals of the Emcomm Extras is to learn what people are doing in different areas. And my impression is every area is doing something a little bit differently, and many of them are a little bit chaotic. I think that's the impression I'm getting here. David, are you more charitable than I am, or does it sound like they've got a little bit of topsy going on down there?
You know, it sounds like my experience from talking to all these people is it sounds like everybody does do it a little different. And, you know, as Darrell said, sometimes it's the repeaters were cheap. Sometimes it's one of the members or a few of the members have a experience in a certain area can help everybody else along. But I think, And you know, I hate to be cliche, but when all else fails.
Oop, and I think the internet just
Jeff fell. And you know the single sideband.
Yeah, I think the internet just failed at that point. Well, as I look at the radar, and let me refresh because I don't think I'm getting a updated version. Yeah, there's not much left to Tropical Storm Emily down there in Florida, and I guess that's good. But it could very well be, Daryl, that we talk to you again, maybe even this hurricane season, as something comes a little bit closer and a little bit worse. But thank you very much for stopping by the show. And I don't know, I'll probably see you at the Orlando Hamcation. And are you going to go out to St. Louis for the DCC?
Yeah. Raise the money. Like I said, hey, I understand completely. I want to go, but it depends on how the money situation is.
Yeah,
and I have one more comment here. I have one more comment here to the Emcomm deal here. Leaving it loosely flexed does have some advantages because we do have regional areas that we could do on NI4CE when we know something is coming, like a storm situation, before impact happens, and if counties need to ask for help, they can. And with the Aries DB database, we can notify people that are coming up. But also, tying things down too strict, I think, may, you know, tie your hands also. But to be honest with you, over the years, it may seem like it's loosely coordinated. We have been able to get the job done, and our served agencies are relatively well pleased with what we've done over the years. And so, I mean, it may not seem like it on the surface, but in the end, we're able to get the job done. Like you say, if all else fails, you know, BHF Simplex. I know a lot of our counties do Simplex debts. And Highlands County, they do one every week. And other counties do one on a regular basis. So we do try to practice all our modes and use all our tools. So when the situation comes, you use the one that works. And it may only be one, but it'll be the one that bails you out. So, you know, it does have some advantages, you know, to not be too much structure, in my opinion, anyway.
Okay, Darrell, well, thank you very much. David's about to get kicked out of his conference room, so let me get his title up here and say thank you, David. You may speak.
Thank you, Gary, and thank you, Darrell, too. Appreciate this. No, I'm on mute. So, yeah, thank you, guys, and glad I was able to join in, and glad it didn't turn out to be a big show for you down there, Darrell, but it was good to talk to you.
Yep, but it could happen. So that is David. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by... There we go. I got the right title right away. Brought to you by you. HamRadioNow.tv is the place to go as David takes his system apart. I will say thanks for watching this show over. You can do it, David.
And
out.
Over and out.
Darrell, you want to say over and out just to get it in there?
I sure can, and I just want to say to all our Aries members here in ACS and CERT. Skywarn, I want to thank you very much for all the work that you do, and we do appreciate all the efforts you do in your individual counties and programs, and keep up the good work. And like I wrote in the editorial to all our hams out there, if I can say, I wrote an article to Aries e-letter, let's be kind one to another. You know, life's too short. You know, if we disagree, that's okay. But let's be civil about it. And let's be kind to one another and try to help one another because we all need it at one time or another. And thank you very much for letting me be on the program today.
Okay, you're welcome. And thank you for being here. Bye-bye, David. I'm gonna click your off button guys. Here. Because he's got to go. Okay, it's once again just you and me, Facebook. And I'm going to get out of here and got some work to do. So I will... sign off Facebook. I think, you know, we pretty much already ended the show, right? Yeah, the show is over. So I will stare right into the camera and say, same with you, recording.